came for me, I tell them love. I took a lot of chow. Are you sweet Princess Silke? Sweet Princess Silke, intelligent, sharing my wisdom. Here I am. And I have to add safe and sound, okay? Yeah, because the circumstance is not really leading to feel any good whatsoever at all. So, let's continue. What happened to the apartment, Princess? What happened to the apartment? Yesterday in my Takalacho, I finished up the last video. What is that, 17 of the day 286? To 89-17. I told you I purchased an apartment in Zihuatanejo. Yes, well, I gave an enganche. I gave a tiny bit of money to safeguard that particular apartment for me. I picked it from a plan. There were several tall buildings. They had a few buildings already built, and many they had not built yet. So I picked a location, an apartment. I put a little bit of a down payment. Yeah, that is Mexico. It was not so very enticing. Yeah, it probably had the view far away from the ocean, but it was on the street and no access to the beach. It was exactly in between Zihuatanejo and Ixtapa. Being Zihuatanejo, the old town, the little village, and Ixtapa evolved into something new. With a casino? I don't know about that. I have no clue about casinos in Mexico. But discotheques, shops and hotels, and then a large marina too. So it was all new. No, it was probably a good investment for anybody to purchase it. Yeah, maybe for the workers. For the workers who would go there. Nothing deluxe. Just a simple thing. So now I had to pay my monthly fees, and I did that. I paid a few months because I had that employment. Yeah, and then I lost my employment, so I had no more money. And since they had not even started to begin to construct that apartment building, I asked for my money back, and I got it all back. And that served me later for surviving. Yeah, I live for this. No, I was going back because Antonio was with me as I purchased the apartment. I was just looking into what he didn't say anything. He was just there. I don't really know. I wasn't it was una ganga. Yes, it was probably a super good deal. Because I had no money. I mean, the employment gave me some, but not much. Particularly since it was just evolving, that kind of Ixtapa, well, I had been there for a long time, but not much happened there. Which, by the way, I got it all wrong. Yesterday, my timeline. So wait, let me do that again. So from February to October, Antonio was with me, and then I kicked him out. And then I met the league, and then I went to Ixtapa, probably in November or something. So I sort of kind of prepared this scene. And then I went back in March, the following year, with Antonio. Yeah, in my 3 days of relapse and my 7 days of reconfiguring my brains about that situation, to want to be with a lame arse. Oh, Raul told me right away. I told Raul, my brother, I said, okay, so called me. Who, he says. Well, he doesn't have to say it. He just listens. So I know he's asking who. Antonio. And he rolled his eyes. Oh, hermana. Once a liar, always a liar, he said. Like, man, no me metas la pata. Don't go there. It's not worthwhile. It's a mistake. No, I liked him for that. He was honest and straightforward. So here you go. It was super inexpensive. I mean, I had not much savings. I have no clue how much I paid. Almost like a rental, I guess. I think it was almost like a rental, where you pay like 1 month or 2 months in advance for just in case. Not much. But over a few months, it helped me to have a little bit of a cushion. When I lost my employment, and then, man, hardship started again. I did all sorts of jobs, whatever I could grab my hand on, but no more sales. I did translations. My God, I got this one job. It fell into my lap. I was so grateful for it. I worked at Bayer. That is a pharmaceutical company, for just a very short amount of time. For a limited amount of time, I was translating instructions, manuals. I think that's what it was. No, it was far away. Which brings me to the subject, if I sold my car, how did I do sales in that company, right? I thought about it as I listened to. Well, my boss was a weirdo. Yeah. He was a cocaine addict, alcoholic, who looked really handsome. In a way, and had charm. And had like many girls hired there. He picked me up from the exhibition I had in the previous employment. He saw me there. And he wanted me in his office. So he sent me a headhunter. And I asked, how much is the salary? And the headhunter said, yeah, whatever you want. Just like that. No, I did not went overboard. I don't know. So now I was in that very pretty office. Very nice. And when I was at that office, I noticed it's only girls working here. No, an engineer came, gave us a course about binary systems, about computers. That was the first company in Mexico who had internet. Probably at the time when internet service had like the space of an entire room. We were selling, okay, so he gave me a list with prospects. And he said, yeah, here, find clients. So I took the list with prospects. I called, and then I had my week full with appointments. So I went back a few hours later and said, so this is my plan for next week. And he looked at me, what are you doing? Well, what you said, I made appointments with the clients. But you cannot just make appointments. You can't get my point, you guys, my people. He was completely lunatic. He just had given me the list to make appointments. No, I did it because, well, he's not used to people actually are efficient. I'm efficient. I work hard. No. That doesn't work this way. Besides, you gotta go with me. Okay. So I went with him. First, we went to one appointment he already had made. And then we went to another appointment he already had made. I don't remember if he went to one of those. I think we did. He said, I had to go with him. I cannot go by myself. Okay. So I went with him. No, it was super interesting, although I was embarrassed. Well, one apartment we had at 8 a.m. and it was a super tiny space because the companies at the time had like a special computer room, a tiny room, like almost like the attic, right? Because computers were not really there yet. And we were waiting for our client to come, him and I, in this super tiny squished space where maybe barely three people could actually stand. So I was very close to him. And he reeked like hot alcohol, disgusting. No, that's how I figured his alcoholism. But he wasn't kind of gone. So later I figured that other thing. And I looked at him and I started looking at people who do that, you know, that drug, how they look. Yeah, they have money because it's a first world drug. Mexico don't do that. They don't have money for that. That's the upside of a third world country. Although I heard in other countries that actually happened. Well, I don't know about it. Horrible. Let's move on. interesting. We went to a supermarket to sell the barcode system. That's what we did too. See, when you go to a supermarket, it's easy. You check out, right? But it used to be that someone had to type in the price and find the price tag on the barcodes didn't exist. That was interesting. So I went with him, I guess. I have no clue. I have no more memory what I did all these months in that company. Yeah, I'm not really sure when I sold my car and when I must look into it if it's really relevant. Because at times I must have had one, right? And then I didn't. I'm not really sure. Of course, when I kicked him out, Antonio, in October, of course I got myself a new car immediately. The same, the Caribe. I went to a used car lot, which would open at Tianguis on the weekends, with Gerardo and Maripaz. Maripaz being his girlfriend. Because I don't know how to buy cars, and Gerardo said, that's easy. You can hear it, he said, you can listen it. What? You listen to the motor. You listen to the motor? Okay. So we went and picked a car. So now I had my car. Now my first was like green and the second was light blue. You know, I wasn't looking at colors. And yeah, lucky I got a car and I could afford it. With papers and all. That matters the world in Mexico. Because anybody can sell you a car without papers. No. So, but this guy, I don't know what happened. I mean, then he became all weirdo and strange. I was sitting in a very pretty office next to another woman who was like la mamá de los pollitos, yeah, like the mother of them all, because she was the oldest one. And she was egotistical. Oof, you have no clue. Because now she worked at that, ooh. It was the IBM company from the States, right? Was it not IBM? I have to think about it again. No, it was General Electric, but which is the same. Doesn't matter, you don't need to know. But this had a different name, the company had a different name, that particular one. But it was, of course, empowered from the United States. Right in the center of Paseo de la Reforma in Mexico City. Very well located. On top of not my favorite cinema, but the largest artistic cinema theater, El Cine Latino. So we had freedom to do things. And eventually he came up with the idea of, now you need to go time check. What? See, he has independent women who work diligently and very thoroughly. They do their job very nicely and very well. And suddenly he started to treat us like we're a little chicken. We had to I've never had that before nor after. Yeah, maybe in the summer job I had when I was 16 when I cleaned the bank. Yeah, I was cleaning a bank. Yeah, I was. So, time check, your little card you put on the time clock, right? Clock in and out. And Lisa and I went like, what the heck, is he stupid? There are no reason for. So she said, yeah. But she didn't say it, she just said, let's go. But what she was saying is, since he's treating us like some asshole, little chicken, let's behave like some little chicken, little children. Let's do it. So she would walk out. We only did that once. She walked up her desk and said, very loud so the entire office could hear, I'm gonna go to the bathroom. She was like that, very loud. Because we were in floor number whatever that was. And so she went one floor below to the elevator. And after a few minutes, I went out to, now I go silent. I went one floor up, yeah, to legitimately Sherlock Holmes, man. So we went down, because at the bottom of that building, there was a tiny restaurant. Yeah, almost like an economical kitchen, which would serve chicken broth. So in the middle of our working hour, we ate chicken broth, just so because, to steal a few minutes from his damn time schedule, I think. Yeah, we were making fun of him in many ways. No, Belize was kind of fun. She was fun. Of course it was her idea. I'm so well behaved and look at her. But it was good. I don't know if that was the following day or was it 3 months later. I don't know when it was. But one good day I come to my office just like usual, like regular. I mean, how many months did I work there? Think about it. I mean, October, November, December, January, February, March. And before October, how many months was that? Maybe a lot, because we just had the exhibition from that company where I still was in February, right? So maybe I worked there like almost a year. I don't really know. I forgot. So one good day I come to my office and I find on my desk a box, a carton box, with my stuff in it. So what is this? Yeah, and the asshole egotistical dummy, she looked at me triumphantly. Yeah, because maybe she was the most important person in the office. But since I arrived, I was prettier than anything else. And he was like, the boss, he was like, erniedrigt. Let me think about it. He was like, eingeschnappt. Oof, I'm thinking German. Okay, so I think what bugged him the most is that I didn't genialise Castleman, that I didn't pay attention to him. I think he was like hurt in his macho ego that I wouldn't look up for him, up to him. Yeah, besides I bring up the mirror so he could see all his nastiness. I mean, his nastiness. Totally abusive and derailed in his brain too. Yeah, because cocaine does that to your brain. Paranoid. Yeah, the paranoia brought him to have us check the time cards, right? What a stupid thing to do. So he was like hurting like a little child. Well, now you go. Huh? Yeah, maybe he treated me like his wife, right? I didn't serve them dinner precisely at the time. Well, I left. Of course I left. And I wanted to sue him. Not for large money, just because suddenly he did not give me a compensation either, which he should have done. But I didn't know about the laws. No, I lost the lawsuit because he purchased the judge. He spent more money in purchasing the judge to rule in his favor, whereas an employer, he had no right to do such a thing, than just giving me a compensation. Like a month's salary so I can go and find another job, for example. See, that was terrifying. But no, I stopped sales. But yes, I did for 2 months. I lived selling my earrings. Literally. That's not really a sales job because it's just offering something really pretty, artistic to people. And then I did translations jobs and whatever I did. And eventually I broke down. I'm not really sure if that was that period or another period. So I called my mother and I said, I'm out of my mind. I can't handle more. I need money. And then she gave me money. She said, okay, I'm going to share your grandmother's inheritance, which was a cheating and a lying thing I heard in the field, because the money was for me, so I could study, because she never gave me anything. And so she offered me a fixed amount of money, which is a tiny amount, each month. I could survive with that. Maybe that is how I inscribed myself to the IFAL, to learn French.
Natural born hustling bitch, check what I've been through. Got mine, took it from you, and now you're slow.